When the people lead, the leaders they will have to follow. And all their lies and their alibis they will have to swallow.
I didn't decide at any moment that I wanted to be an environmentalist, but something inside me did absolutely click. It was just one of those things that just kept me going.
I keep quoting Margaret Mead. You never doubt that a few committed individuals can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. My father was over-optimistic all his life. As a teenager, he thought that great European classical music would save the world. He was in charge of the music department at University of California. But his fellow professors radicalized him, and he became a socialist. And when World War I came along, he made speeches against imperialist war and got fired. Then he got a grand idea to with my mother, who was a very good violinist, they kind of have a one-family Chautauqua tour. He built by hand, it took him almost 2 years, one of America's first automobile trailers. Tongue and groove maple, brass screws, four big wheels with solid rubber tires. It was pulled by a Model T Ford, average speed 20 or 25 miles an hour. And finally, my mother put down her foot. This is not going to work. And they went back and became teachers at what's now Juilliard. Your parents, did they work in the Bronx?
My dad was born and raised in a town called Americus, Georgia. And it was as segregated could get. He was actually the son of a slave. So his approach to the world is very practical, you know, in terms of, as a black person, winding your way through this world. You know, understanding that you had to create allies along the way. And, you know, neither one of them would ever say that they were, you know, major participants in the civil rights, you know, movement at all. But in their own quiet way, I think what they did instill in me was that you gotta know how to play with a lot of different people if you're gonna get anything done in this world.
I was a nature nut as a kid. I built myself a teepee at age 10. I put a feather in my, something around my head, made myself a bow and arrow, shot it at rabbits, never hit one.
Have been abandoned or burned. That's 16% of the housing stock. 43,000 apartments have been lost in the last few years. Unemployment stands at 20% for adults, more than 30% for teenagers.
So I grew up in an era where the South Bronx was the epitome of urban blight. I mean, really, I remember so clearly watching so many buildings burn, you know, around me. It was almost an everyday occurrence for a really long time. Economic forces when I was a kid made it easier for landlords to, you know, commit arson against their own buildings and collect insurance money. So seeing that kind of, you know, degradation of life was something, and knowing that the media proclaimed us, you know, as just some of the most awful things in the world, it absolutely reflected on me and on my neighbors, and I left. When I was starting grad school and was broke, and I needed a place to stay, which was my parents' home. And fortunately, they let me in, which was good. But the funny thing was is that had I not moved back home, you know, and seen for myself the environmental degradation that our community was dealing with, and discovered that the city and the state were planning on building a huge waste facility that would have brought almost 40% of the city's residential waste to the neighborhood. We were already handling 40% of the city's commercial waste in my little community that was only about a mile and a quarter square mile radius. Mm-hmm. Fought that, you know, waste facility, and we beat it, and, you know, worked with the city after that to help create a much more sustainable solid waste management plan. And it hasn't fully, you know, been accepted just yet, but we're hoping that Albany will come to their senses and, you know, recognize that it's the best possible, most equitable thing we can have, you know, in the city of New York.
How did you get started in the South Bronx? Mm-hmm. And what are the problems you've run into in the South Bronx?
When I started working along the Bronx River, it was actually as part of something called the Bronx River Working Group, and it was a collection of more than 60 different groups. Yeah, it was amazing that, you know, schools, businesses, community organizations, city, state, federal agencies, and what now, you know, a few years later, we've got the first waterfront park, you know, that the South Bronx has seen in more than 60 years. And I think that is probably the most incredible gift that folks can give to themselves, like the ability to see how their liberation is tied up, you know, across different sectors, you know, with other people and other groups.
Now sing it pretty.
When you first had the initial idea for the Clearwater, was the year I was born, 1966. Oh. And I was like, for as long as I've been alive, you've been doing this work longer.
I often get ideas, but I don't know how to develop them. What happened with the Clearwater was that somebody loaned me a book about the sailboats mm-hmm. that sailed on the Hudson. They had hundreds of them. In 1860, there were like 400 big sloops. These were the most beautiful boats we ever knew, and they'll never be seen again. I stayed up till about 2 o'clock in the morning, writing a letter to the man who loaned me the book. Said, they built a replica of the Mayflower. If we got enough people together, we could build a replica of a Hudson River sloop.
Mm-hmm.
And then I forgot about it. And then he found a person who would let us run a fundraising event on his lawn, and in his living room, we set up a nonprofit organization called the Hudson River Sloop Restoration, Inc. Mm-hmm. Nonprofit. 3 years later, this beautiful boat was built up in Maine. In 1949, September, there was a huge crowd with all this publicity, like 10 or 20,000 people.
Wow.
I decided I'd take the whole family there. And I was going to sing just two or three songs at the beginning of the program before Paul Robeson started.
Thousands of angry locals surround the concert, protesting Robeson, Seeger, and the other performers.
And at the end of the concert, it was a very slow getting out, but there was only one narrow dirt road leading out of the field, so there were seven of us in the car. Mm-hmm. We hadn't gone more than a few feet, I see glass in the road.
No.
And I say to the family, uh-oh, because around the corner was a pile of stones, each about as big as a tennis ball or a
right.
baseball, and a young man heaving them with all his force at every single car that came by. So there was crash, and then around the next corner was another pile of stones and another crash. We had three windows on each side and a divided windshield, eight, and they were all broken not once but several times. Mm. So I think there must have been between 15 and 20 piles of stones. They must have been covered up with canvas or something, so we didn't notice them
on
when
the way.
We drove in.
Right.
There was a policeman standing about 50 feet mm-hmm. from somebody mm-hmm. throwing stones. Mm-hmm. And I stopped the car and tried to roll the window down, but it was so splintered I only got it about an inch down. I shouted, "Officer, aren't you going to do something?" And he just shouted, "Move on, move on." Mm.
A riot ensued when concert goers were assaulted as they tried to leave. 140 people were injured.
Out all over here. The police are fighting the cops. Oh, this is horrible. And they are beating up a Negro. They're clubbing him.
Now, the interesting thing, and this is the important part of the story, signs went up in Peekskill saying, "Wake up America," a bumper sticker sign, uh-huh. about 5 inches high and, mm-hmm. and 2 feet wide. Mm-hmm. "Wake up America," mm-hmm. Peekskill did. About 5 weeks later, they all came down. They were on bumpers, they were in windows, in stores, in gas stations.
What do you mean they all came down?
The signs disappeared. It must have been thousands of them in Peekskill.
Like taken off?
They were taken off. They were taken off the bumpers of cars. They were, and why? It seems that in Europe, they were horrified. They said those are the same signs that went up in Germany after Kristallnacht, when Hitler said, "You should throw stones. Wake up, Germany." Munich did. "Throw stones at all the Jewish storekeepers." And they said, "Is America going fascist?" Well, a lot of people thought they were, but I was not convinced. Mm. I said, there's a stronger tradition of freedom of speech in this country than you would believe. Mm. And I was right. What advice would you give to people in other cities who find out something really bad is aiming for their neighborhood, like a waste facility?
Mm-hmm. The main one would be get to know what the real problem is, and two, find out who your allies are, you know, and look for connections that you can make even across various sectors. You know, like there's, I think, a really common, you know, misconception in some ways, especially with folks in the social justice community, that you only work with folks in the social justice community and everybody else is the devil. If the world was that simple, you know, we actually wouldn't be in the mess that we're in right now, would we? But I'm just so glad I didn't get really involved in this work until I was already old. How old? I mean, I was 30 when I started doing this work. But, like, I didn't grow up in the social justice movement. I didn't know who you weren't supposed to talk to. And I didn't know that, you know, even within, that I didn't understand that there were even fractions within, you know, the social justice movement. So I just figured, you know, I'll talk to everybody and, you know, and it'll, we're all in it together. And it was a difficult, you know, thing for me, you know, to realize that, you know, sometimes we don't all get along. And it gets in the way of real progress. And not to say that I have all the answers, but I do know that I like to, you know, if there's an issue or a concern, like, I'll talk to somebody about it. They may not return my calls, but I'll try, you know, to reach out.
A lot of environmentalists look down on unions. They're just causing problems. Mm-hmm. And a lot of unions look down on environmentalists. They're just causing problems.
Uh-huh.
And we're starting to work together. We'll see. But I'd say that my life was turned around by Dr. King. Why did he start with a bus boycott? Why did he start with something important like schools or jobs or voting? I mean, couldn't a bus boycott come later? It's just a mind. When you face an opponent over a broad front, mm-hmm. you don't aim at the opponent's strong points. Mm-hmm. You aim for some little off inside that they can afford, but you win it.
Mm-hmm.
And having won that bus mm-hmm. boycott, 13 months it took him to do it, Then he moved on to other things. Mm-hmm. I was 9 years older than he was. I only met him twice.
Wow.
Once was down in the Highlander Folk School, that tiny little school in Tennessee. Mm. This is one more example. This tiny little school. Rosa Parks had come there. Miles Horton had started it during the 1930s. They were getting into Jim Crow and segregation. And at the end of the week or two seminars, Miles went around the circle. What are you going to do when you get home to put into practice what you've learned here? Mm. And one woman said, I'm going to start voter registration. Another man said, well, I got to start before that. Some of my people can't read or write. Mm. And they came to Rosa, and she said, I don't know what I'm going to do. Well, they said, you must think of something. We'll get back to you. All right, now what are you going to do? She said, I really don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm going to do something.
Mm. Well, boy, did she.
Well, actually, one of the best songs I ever made up was the made up about King. Can I sing it?
Please.
I'll try it. Even though nobody's here to sing it with me, I'll sing it.
I don't think I know this one.
Down in Alabama, 1955. Not many of us here today were then alive. A young Baptist preacher led a bus boycott. He showed a way for a brand new day without firing a shot. Don't say it can't be done. The battle just begun. Take it from Dr. King. You too can learn to sing, so drop the gun. Those must have been an exciting 13 years. Young heroes, young heroines. There was laughter, there were tears. Students sitting down at lunch counters. Your story's got to be learned by not just Chicago and Seattle, but Phoenix, Arizona, and all sorts of smaller places.
In different places that you wouldn't find necessarily, that you wouldn't think of when you think of the South Bronx.
Yeah.
Like I've been talking with folks in Appalachia. You know, I don't care if it's the protection, you know, of a river or the creation, you know, of jobs, you know, for a group of people that haven't had them, or just the idea of freedom that can be interpreted in many different ways by different people. But again, everybody knows it when they see it. Or everybody knows when it's been violated. And I think the thing that's really gonna, I think, save us, and if I was gonna like say it to a bunch of kids, that it is the fact that knowing that there are so many people, there are so many different perspectives, that each one of them is valid, and learning how to work across different sections and sectors is truly important. So it sounds like you are pretty hopeful.
I'm more hopeful than I was after Hiroshima. Mm. 61 years ago, I thought surely within a few decades, some damn fool would drop one of those bombs, and then others would be dropped. And if we weren't killed, we'd be poisoned by the fallout. I believe the American people are going to make some absolutely wonderful changes within the next few years. Mm. A wide variety of people, often who don't even know of each other's existence, after 88 years of trying to get people singing. I can't sing much at all now, but I play a tune and pretty soon they're singing. I give them the words. You know, in church they call it lining out the hymn. I'll do this with old pop songs. I says, you know this tune. Now I give you Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and they all sing it, and I just play the accompaniment. Say, way up high, they sing it. There's a land I heard of once in a lullaby. They sing it. So I'm just lining out the hymn.
Lining out the hymn. That's a nice way of looking at it.
You know, the last line of each verse just repeats, so even if you never heard it before, you could help me out. Ham is gonna be the death of me, Lord, Lord. Ham is gonna be the death of me.
I think kids will appreciate all sorts of different things, mm-hmm. as long as they don't think that we know all the answers.
Uh-huh, yeah. They've got great BS detectors, don't they?
Yeah. I keep thinking that somewhere in the world there might be a kid in diapers right now who may write a melody that is so beautiful that the whole world wants to sing it. Mm. Who knows? Who knows? Do you speak to kids in school often? Mm-hmm.
Often enough, you know, there's the youngest group I've ever spoken to were first graders, which was pretty interesting, you know, to take a presentation that I do, you know, for college students and even older than that. And, you know, kids understand what justice is. They understand what dignity is. And I think more importantly, they know what it is when it's been violated. And you can absolutely teach that, you know, to a young person. You can teach them, you know, that their future, that their own liberation, you know, is tied up to the successful relationships that you can either nurture or the ones that you can destroy. And that all of you are together, you know, on it one way or another, either through curation or through destruction. And kids instinctively get that. Adults, unfortunately, have a harder time recognizing that.
Got more to unlearn.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Don't we, though?
Trying to figure how we can survive this modern age. And I've tried to put up a brave front saying, oh, sure we are. But I have to admit, people like Kurt Vonnegut may be right, you know. He says, he feels that the human race won't last out this century. Mm. I reply, says, God only knows what the future is going to be, but he gave us brains, and if we use these brains, who knows? These may be the most exciting next few decades that anybody has ever known anywhere. Now, I'm going to have to ask you to sing with me. And you two over there, and you over there. Sing, don't say it can't be done. Let me hear you.
Don't say it can't be done.
The battle's just begun.
The battle's just begun.
Here's a hard one. Take it from Dr. King. Take it from Dr. King. Now sing those three lines. Don't say it can't be done. The battle.
The battle's just begun.
Take it.
Take it from Dr. King.
You too can learn to sing. You too can learn to sing. So drop the gun. So drop
the gun.
Now you know the whole chorus. Don't say it can't be done. The battle's just begun.
Take it from Dr. King.
You too can learn to sing. So drop the gun. Songs, songs, songs kept them going and growing. They didn't know all the millions of seeds that they were sowing. They were singing on marches, even singing in jail. Songs gave them courage to believe they would not fail. Don't say it can't be done. The battle's just begun. Take it from Dr. King. You can learn to sing so clap again. You need a trumpet somewhere.
Thank you.